Good evening, and thank you for coming to the Garfield Ridge Civic League's Candidate Forum here at Ward Hall at St. Jane de Chantel Church. We thank St. Jane's for the use of its facility today. I know already that everyone's cell phone has been silenced, right? We can do that. And I can do that too, I think. There we go. Thank you. I also know that all folks here will be respectful toward each other. If you don't act respectfully, I'll have you speak with Father Ed, the shepherd administrator here, afterwards about your behavior. My name is Ed Kozak, and I am your moderator this evening. I'm a longtime resident of the 23rd Ward and of Chicago. Unfortunately, boundaries were changed. I am now in the 14th Ward, so I cannot vote for any of the aldermanic candidates here tonight. I would like everyone to know that I have been a football referee for 31 years now, so I know how to make arbitrary calls and decisions, and I know how to time contests as well. So I expect to have an informative and educational forum here this evening. I am a longtime member of the Civic League, and I'm honored to be here on this nice January evening. I would like to thank President Rick Techman of the Civic League for his efforts in putting this get-together in place. Will we please thank Rick for the work he has done going into this forum. It's in the back. I'd also like to thank Ms. Kay Shelton and the League of Women Voters of DeKalb for her outstanding guidance and assistance with this forum. Mr. Tim Haddock is here videotaping the forum tonight. He is from the excellent online newspaper, the Southwest Chicago Post. You will be able to find this event on their website very shortly. Also, CAN TV is here on cable television. They're videotaping the forum here tonight. We thank them for coming as well. Here is your disclaimer. The Garfield Ridge Civic League is nonpartisan and does not support or endorse or oppose, for that matter, any candidates for office. If you'd like to become a member of this great neighborhood group, please see Mr. Techman at the conclusion of this forum. Mr. Tony Della Concha, another longtime local resident, will be our timekeeper. He will display warning signs at 1 minute, 30 seconds, 15 seconds, and stop. Going past stop may mean a bell will ring. When I hear the bell, I will move on, whether or not you have completed your answer. Garfield Ridge Civic League members have selected appropriate questions that have been written down by audience members as they entered tonight. We will alter the order of the candidates going first, fielding the questions. Each candidate has 2 minutes to answer each question. He or she may conclude in less than 2 minutes. Only me, the moderator, may ask a follow-up question to the original question posed. Please withhold all applause until after the aldermanic forum is concluded. Please do not interrupt with noise between answers or questions. And again, we hope to have some mayoral candidates here later on after our aldermanic candidates are concluded. So we are beginning with our aldermanic candidate part of the forum. We will give each candidate 4 minutes to introduce themselves and explain why he or she should be the next alderman serving the people of the 23rd Ward. So we'll do the introductions first. We'll begin in alphabetical order. We'll start with candidate Martin Arteaga. Okay, parliamentary move here, I guess. Would you like to go first, Anna? Martin has yielded to you.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you for having me here. My name is Anna Goral, and some of you might remember me from 4 years ago when I ran against current alderman Mike Zalewski in a three-way run. I lost the run of election with 278 votes, so less than 300. And my name, as I said, is Anna Goral, for those who do not remember or those who do not know me. I am a long-time resident of Garfield Ridge. I've been in Garfield Ridge and Midway area for over 30 years. When I came to this country 32 years ago, the first thing that I realized that with no education, I cannot get anywhere. So the first thing that I did in the very first month is I enrolled at school just to learn the English. Once I was confident enough that my English is okay, I went to DePaul University. When I graduated with high honors, majoring in computer science. I was then dean list every single year. I was member of Phi Beta Kappa, and I was one of the best students at DePaul University. Upon graduation, I was selected one of two students out of over 300 students at DePaul University to work for Arthur Anderson. I worked there for about 9 years as a software development and system analyst. I work at Arthur Anderson Tax Consulting Group, which brought me very close working relationship with people who are experts in taxes, finances, and consulting. I worked there on different projects, and in a couple of years I became a project leader. I supervised and monitored a lot of people working on important software developing. Those skills that I gained there in taxes and in financing and in consulting gave me the background to move on to a next to endeavor. I always felt that my calling is to work with people and for people. That's why I quit working for Arthur Anderson and I opened up my first business, a real estate agency. In a couple of years, I became the top producer in Midwest. I was doing one of the best sales for tour operators and for airlines. And in a year or two, I became a wholesaler. A lot of agencies were buying tickets through me because of my production. And because that, I got a lot of contracts with important airlines, with major airlines, with loud Polish airlines, with Scandinavian, with Austrian. And I also was only agency in Chicagoland that got a contract with American Transair to fly direct to Hawaii. And I have to tell you also that I chartered 4 planes from American Transair and I flew nonstop flight from Chicago to Krakow. After September 11, the real estate, the travel agency got a hit, and I moved on to a next business, and I opened up a real estate agency, and it's still in operation today. Real estate agency gave me the opportunity to work very close with people who are losing their jobs, people who are losing their homes, people who were being foreclosed upon. And this is where I realized that there is a problem, that somebody needs to work with those people to help them through the hardship. And this was one of the main reasons that I decided 4 years ago to run for office. 4 years ago, Alderman Zaluski got another chance, another 4 years, nothing has changed. So I decided to run again, and this time there is a lot of more issues. All the issues that were very relevant 4 years ago are even more relevant today. So that's why I'm running, and I hope to get your support. Thanks.
I'd like to introduce Martin Arteaga.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Martin Arteaga, and I'm running here for Alderman in the 23rd Ward. I'm running for several reasons. As I've lived here in the Southwest Side for the past 23 years, I've seen the degradation of the Southwest Side. And now that I have my son, baby Marty, I want him to have great schools, great parks, and safe streets. My story starts a long time ago. My story starts back in 1966, when my parents were married in a small town in Mexico. My dad received a wedding present. It was a baby pig from my grandmother. And that baby pig eventually grew up and had little piglets, which my parents were able to sell. enough to get money to be able to come to the United States because they knew they could do better. Since being here, they went forward to reach out to their American dream. They became union workers and Nabisco. So if you guys like Oreo cookies and Chips Ahoy, thank you very much. We appreciate that. But that allowed my family to get into the middle class through union jobs. And my dad continued, we could do better. We lived in Pilsen for the first part of my life. We moved when I was 14 years old to the southwest side. Pilsen was very gang-ridden. And my dad thought we could do better. So we had a single family home that he purchased on 61st and St. Louis. Since then, I've been here for 23 years. And they always told me when I was a kid growing up that I could become anything that I want in this country, so long as I studied hard and I worked hard. And now today I stand before you, graduating from DePaul University in political science, going on to graduate school at Northwestern University for public policy. And now I stand before you and tell you we could do better. There's several things here in the 23rd Ward that have been lacking over the past 20 years of the Alderman's reign. When we talk about redevelopment or crime or education, these are issues that need attention. Redevelopment, we have an airport in our backyard with a lot of empty lots around it and 4-hour motels, which create a negative environment for a family-based southwest neighborhood. We need to redevelop that area and create more jobs, more union jobs, permanent jobs, local jobs, bring in new entertainment, new restaurants, liven up the place. I want to get rid of the 4-hour motels, which Alderman Zalewski takes money from, and that's not something that I'm in for. Crime, I want to see a holistic approach of keeping kids off the street by creating more programs, and I also want to increase the education. I have a volunteer named Alyssa. She has to travel 4 hours every day to get her education on the north side at Lane Tech because we don't have great schools here. We need to make sure that we don't lose $8 million like we did this year. And we need to push forward because we can do better. Thank you very much.
We were informed a few minutes ago that Alderman Mike Zalewski will not be here tonight. He has kidney stones. Speaking on behalf of Alderman Mike Zalewski is Mr. Jerry Herkes.
Thank you, Ed. Thank you, Rich and Ed and the Garfield Ridge Civic League, Father Ed and St. Jane for hosting us this evening. I'm here on behalf of Alderman Mike Zalewski. Mike had every intention of being here, but unfortunately, he had a kidney stone attack and will be out of commission for tonight. He apologizes for his absence from this important event. Alderman Zalewski has lived the entire life in the 23rd Ward. He started out on the back of a garbage truck and has a great understanding of city services and a strong commitment to public safety. You may have seen Alderman Zalewski recently at your door. He's been working very hard canvassing the neighborhood to have personal conversations with voters about the election and answer their questions. Lately, Alderman Zalewski's been endorsed by the sergeants of the City of Chicago Police Department, the Fraternal Order of Police, the Chicago Teachers Union, and recently the Chicago Federation of Labor. If you have any questions for the Alderman, ladies and gentlemen, please visit me afterwards. I'll be more than glad to make sure he gets your questions. Again, the Alderman wishes he could be here and sends his apologies. Thank you. Thank you, Ed.
All right, let's begin with the question and answer period. We'll go back and forth between the candidates, and we'll start with a very simple and short question to begin with. Candidate Arteaga will be first on this one. Simply, when will sidewalks be fixed in the ward?
Thank you very much for that question. That's a very valid question, because there is a lot of infrastructure improvements that need to be made throughout the whole ward. As one of my first acts as alderman, I will be creating community action groups in which people from all over the ward, from Garfield Ridge over to Chicago Lawn and everywhere in between, Archer Heights, Clearing, where everybody can serve on one of these community action groups and be able to participate on what needs they have in their particular section of the ward. And it is by that means that I would like to make sure that every area of the ward is addressed. So to answer that question, I'm gonna leave it up to the people of the 23rd Ward to be able to have their input as to what areas are most in need.
This is a very good question, but I have to tell you that I'm surprised by it, because $1.3 million that the ward gets for every year for infrastructure improvement supposedly goes to street resurfacing and alleys. If you go throughout any neighborhood, if you drive main streets, you will see no beautification, you will see no flower pots, no benches, no trees, no you name it, nothing. No restaurants, no coffee shops. All the money goes to infrastructure improvement. So I'm really surprised that $1.3 million that we get every single year doesn't do the streets. If you look at any social media, any bloggings, any networks that we have here, all you read is the praising Alderman Zalewski, how well he takes care of our infrastructure, that our streets are paved, that our curbs are done, that our alleys are also done. Everything is greatly done, but I'm really surprised at this question, because supposedly everything should be really nice, but it's not. So I'm proposing to do participatory budgeting, where people will decide how much of that $1.3 million is gonna go into infrastructure improvements for street resurfacing and curbs, and the rest of the money is gonna go to beautification, because we do need to build something here that we don't have to go, if we have visitors over from some other areas, that we don't have to go to LaGrange or Orland Park to take them where, because we are ashamed of what we have in our ward. Every year it's worse and worse and worse, and we really need some vision. We need some younger people encouraged and involved, and we need people's input to decide what we need to do in the ward, because we need to do a lot. Thank you.
I think this is an excellent question. Our second question, we have so many city workers here in our section of the city. Candidates, what is your plan to reduce the pension debt and pay off the balance owed by the city of Chicago to city pensions? Candidate Garrell would be first.
Lots smarter people than me have been debating about this for years. So do not expect a candidate who a lot of people call rookie, inexperienced, to answer the question. Everything comes with the willingness to do the right thing. If we have, I see a couple of, I see aldermen from the 22nd Ward. He's one of the progressive candidates, so we have aldermen. If we have more aldermen like this, people who are representing, aldermen who representing people to do exactly what they were elected to do, and if we get more people like this in a city hall, then we can get something resolved. Nothing is gonna change, because a lot of our aldermen are working for special interest, for big businesses. They forgot why they were elected. They forgot that their job is to take care of us. The main responsibility, the main responsibility is to us. We are their top priority. Once they remember that, it's gonna be really easy to solve all the problems. I am not a union member, and I've never been, because I've been always a professional. But my husband has been union for 30 years. Two of my sons are union members. So union is very important to me. I will do everything I can to resolve it so it not, so the people who are already retired do not lose any benefits. It would be really unfair to tackle the people who already retired, because they retired, they put a lot of years in their job, and they retired with the promise that they're gonna get their benefits. The new people who are just about to retire, everything is can be worked out, but we have to be willing to talk to people, go to a round table and talk about it and resolve it. Thank you.
I'm a strong believer that these pensions should be paid to our city workers. A lot of them have worked hard for many years, and they deserve it. So there's several ways that we can address this issue, and that's about creating money to be able to fund these pensions. An idea that's been tossed around is the LaSalle Street tax and taxing financial transactions. I'm for that. I think that that's a good way of being able to increase our funds. Another way is by being more innovative with our existing city government infrastructure. When we're talking about innovation, I'm talking about cutting waste from all departments. I'm talking about department heads making the decisions within their own department and saying, all right, this is where we could cut some waste and we could actually reward people for saving money. I know a lot of departments usually, they want to spend every dollar that they can, because if they don't spend it all, then the next year they'll have less in their budget. So that's one way that we can do it. Alderman Zalewski voted to decrease the benefits, and then he also voted to raise healthcare costs by 40%. I talked to Mr. Lauer, who lives on 57th and Nottingham, and he doesn't know how he's gonna do it. He's a 79-year-old man who has his wife in a nursing home. He's been retired after working many years for the city of Chicago. This shouldn't be. We can do better.
Thank you. Our third question, and this has happened to every one of us in this room, I can assure you. What are we going to do about freight trains blocking traffic for more than 15 minutes? Candidate Arteaga.
Freight trains. I had to wait a little while just to get over here on the way over here. No. Freight trains is a major issue that people have to deal with on a daily basis. As I've been walking through Clearing, Garfield Ridge, I've heard this issue numerous times. We have to get the funding in order to do that, and we're going to have to work together with not only the city of Chicago, but our state legislators as well as our federal legislators. We need to make sure that we have different pools of money that are put together in order to make something happen. I would say about 3 months ago or so, I went to a Garfield Ridge Neighborhood Association meeting where they actually had somebody from the railway system that was talking about what they were proposing to do on Central Avenue and Archer to do an underpass. After concluding a conversation with the gentleman, he told me there's no funding for this. They have $3 million to do a study, but that's it. They don't have any more funds to actually create the project. That it would take roughly about $70 million to create it. So right now we're in a pension, in a deficit overall, not only the state, but the city. And we need to be able to raise those funds, but we gotta get out of this rut. We gotta get out of this rut as a city and as a state. So I look forward to working with all the other aldermen here in the Southwest side to create some smart ways to address this issue. And I also look forward to working with our state legislators, our state representatives in the area to be able to come to some type of conclusion and find some answers for this. But right now, we really have a dilemma. So we look forward to working with that.
I cannot even think how many times I witnessed, and I was part of discussion about this. How many times I went to Garfield Ridge Civic League that we had elected officials addressing this issue. How many times we went to Garfield Ridge Business of Commerce meetings that we had elected officials addressing this issue. I've been here 32 years, and I remember when I started going to Daly College to learn English, this is the first one that I was introduced to this issue. 30 years later, we still have the same issue. It's really, I believe that this is our fault because we are not going after elected officials and request, demand that they are doing what they're supposed to be doing. You know, giving easy answer, oh, we work with the legislators, we will secure the funds. We need to ask them, when you're gonna do it? What you're gonna do about it? And we have to be more resourceful. Finding the businesses, finding the grants, finding people who would help us to write those grants. I know that I spoke with Congressman Lipinski about 2 years ago about it, and I know that there was some funding that was supposed to do preliminary study, but this is where it all ended. I know that for Archer and Central, there are two proposals that finally maybe something is gonna move forward. But we cannot stop just there. We have to be, I mean, I am just a businesswoman and I know how to take care of my business. If we have elected officials who are elected to take care of their people, why are not doing their job? That's their job. They have to do everything to make our life easier. It increases the response time for 911 calls, for any emergency. People are getting late to work. There is an unbelievable traffic. Sometimes it takes 2 hours to get home from work. So let's go after all the elected officials and demand on them that they look into it and they resolve the issue. Thank you.
And candidate Gorell will be the first one to answer our next question. Is the use of TIF district money, tax increment financing, the most effective way to boost the development here? Why or why not?
I love this question. This TIF business was part of my platform 4 years ago. A lot of people might not realize that TIF is set up a district for 23 years. People who live in this district will be paying property taxes. But let's assume if you pay your property taxes $5,000 today, this year, and your property taxes go up every year. So for 23 years, the difference between that $5,000 that you pay today is gonna go into the special TIF fund. The TIF money originally was designed to just spur economic development. It was a good idea, but somewhere along the way, it went bad. It went to finance wealthy projects, projects that have nothing to do with our community. And our politicians got very smart because reporting, they can create, you know, TIF districts overlapping another TIF district. This way, the money from our money that we put into TIF funds are being funneled away to some other projects. This money is supposed to go to our schools, our businesses, our parks, our playgrounds. Make sure that our tax dollars works for us, not for some other private business, whoever gets more money, whoever gets more clout, more influence, this is where the money goes. So again, we need to make sure that we know, we should have public hearings so the public knows how much money we have in TIF's accounts and how can we distribute this money, who can get benefit from it, because this is our money, we all should benefit from it. Thank you.
All right, tax increment financing is an issue that has been here for some time, and we do have several TIFs, I believe six TIF districts here that are part of the 23rd Ward. My take on it is mend it, don't end it. These TIFs need to be used for its intended purposes, just like Anna just stated. The original intent for TIFs was to create development in areas that that are blighted, okay? And that has been stretched to mean downtown at this point. So we need to make sure that, these TIF funds are used effectively and for its intended purposes. The second thing we need to do with these TIF funds is make sure that everything's transparent. All right, there's no mistaking that there's corruption in the city of Chicago. And when you look at TIF funds, you know, let's use Shop and Save for example. They received $3 million in TIF funds. All right, from the 23rd Ward. Alderman Zalewski got $16,000 back for his campaign coffers from Shop and Save. Now that needs to be transparent. We cannot have that type of thing happening here in the ward, and we need to use it to redevelop the Midway Airport region. We need to make sure that the TIF funds are also used to help small businesses develop, so as they want to increase and expand their business. These funds are there not only for the big boys, the big corporations, but to help small businesses along Archer, 63rd, 55th, develop their themselves as well.
Moving right along, I have noted a decline in services in the 23rd Ward, i.e. pothole repairs, tree trimming, etc. How will you improve them? Candidate Arteaga.
All right, well, city services are key, because that's the most basic thing that an alderman should do, is make sure that the city services are delivered. And the city workers that deliver those services will continue to be there regardless of which alderman is in place. The main thing is, how do we effectively make sure that these city services are delivered? Now, throughout my campaign, we've run a smart online campaign where I want to make sure that people from the 23rd Ward are able to communicate with our office. Not necessarily that you have to come down to my office, but if you want to submit a city service request online, you can do so. Not only that, but from this whole start of this campaign, I've been very accessible to everybody. My office is down the street on Archer and Kilbourne, 5215 South Archer. My doors are always open to make sure that everybody can come in and request a city service, even if I'm not currently the alderman right now. But we want to make sure that everybody has those city services available, and that your voice is heard when you need these things. And if we need to push certain department heads to make sure that these services are here, then that's what we'll do. Thank you.
We're going back to the question that we had before with this $1.3 million. This is so much money that I do not understand, you know, why would we even had a question like that? Why would we even question city services if they are done with our taxpayers' money? Every time you pay your property tax, part of that money goes towards your city services. So things like garbage pickup, trimmed, snow plowed, it's a must. It's a job description. Every month, this is the minimum that every alderman has to do for his or her constituents. So if we do not have minimum of our elected officials, then how can we talk about something different? Something that would you know, we 23rd Ward residents don't even think in terms of, you know, what else can we do with the money, because we always are short with the money, short with the services. So do not think that if somebody comes, if Aldermanic office or somebody comes to trim your tree, they're doing you a favor. You paid for it. Your tax money paid for it. So don't be afraid to go to Alderman's office and ask for requests. And I'm Polish-American descent. And I do not understand, there's still huge population of Polish-speaking people, Polish-American descent here. I do not understand how such a diverse community doesn't have anybody who speaks Polish in Alderman's office. We should have one bilingual people. Everybody should speak at least two languages. We should have Hispanic-speaking person, Polish-speaking person, and any other languages that we have. We have a lot of different representation of different nationalities, different languages. We have to make sure that everybody's taking care of, no matter what language, what color, what religion. And this is where it all starts, because we get a notion that we get privilege if we get the study services. And this is not the way it should be. Thank you.
Candidate Grell will be first on this question. What are your plans to rejuvenate Archer Avenue? I'm tired of fast food places.
I encourage everyone to look at my website, annagorol.com, on my platform is. One of the issues, very small issue, adopt a corner. It doesn't, this issue would really beautify a lot of corners in our streets, and it doesn't have to come from the menu money. It can be sponsored by businesses, by schools, by individual people. If you go Hinsdale or Rockway or whatever, you will see a lot of benches, fountains, flower pots, and you see a plaque founded by XYZ family, founded by Goral family, founded by this, founded by that. And once I posted this on my website, I got someone called me from a high school and said, you know what, we would be very interested to adopt this corner and just beautify it and put the plaque, class of 2015. This doesn't really take a lot to beautify the streets. If 4 years ago, it was one of my platform to beautify Cicero Avenue. Unfortunately, Cicero Avenue is not part of the 23rd Ward anymore. So we have, really what we have is very small portion of Archer Avenue commercial properties that are left with the 23rd Ward. Everything else went to some other wards. Part of it went to the 22nd Ward, part of it went to 13th Ward, and part of it went to 14th Ward. So whatever we have left in the 23rd Ward, we have to make sure that we get a lot of restaurants, that we don't have to take our friends to Orland Park or Le Monde or LaGrange to entertain them. We still have a huge potential. We have young people who would be glad to create committee and do some really good ideas what we can do with this. It doesn't have to be funded with aldermanic money. It can be thought about it and executed by residents if we want to do it.
All right, business development is very important to any community. Because a strong business district means you have a pretty strong community. University Village is one of the projects that I worked on. And if you guys remember what Maxwell Street used to look like, and you see what it looks like today, you see a very different area. It's booming. There's a lot of students there. There's a lot of commerce there. So I already bring some experience on that behalf. And that was a community-developed project in which different community organizations were part of it. We made sure that local people got jobs as that development happened, and that women and minority contractors were also being able to get opportunities there. So there's a couple things that we can do for the Archer Avenue area. Obviously working with the organization that's already existing, great. And we want to talk about also creating more parking. Any business person knows that if you don't have parking, your business is going to be very limited as to how many patrons you can have. So that's key. Using TIF money to help expand some of these businesses and create more parking areas so that there's a business district that can actually thrive. So if you park in one area, just as LaGrange does, you park in one area, you can walk to many areas from there. All right, that's something that we can use. And even along the Midway Airport area, we can use the existing parking structures for that. Another thing that we can do is make sure that these businesses employ people from the community. If you look at Checkers, we know that a lot of the people that are employed there are not from the community or the 23rd Ward. So we need to make sure that we develop in a smart way, but that we also make sure that these jobs are coming to mostly people in the community first.
Our next question. What is your stance on speed zones and speed cameras in Chicago? Should signage improve alerting citizens of these speed zones?
All right, so red light cameras, speed cameras. How many of you guys like them? I don't see too many hands up there. No, I'm against them as well. There's not a lot of empirical evidence that shows that these types of red light cameras and speed cameras improve safety any much more. In fact, sometimes they tend to make people press the brakes and then they cause an accident themselves. They're put in a lot of communities, taking a lot of money from hardworking blue-collar people that are trying to make ends meet. All of a sudden, you're hit with a $100 ticket, and it doesn't feel good. So I'm against these red light cameras. I'm against the speed cameras. I think if they exist, one, they need to warn people, not be speed traps. But two, I would like to abolish them, period.
Again, this issue was part of my platform 4 years ago, and nothing has changed. I believe that they were to generate revenue for the city, and I still believe it. There is no evidence support otherwise. They do not increase our safety. They just take your dollars out of the honest working taxpayers and put it in the city coffers. And no matter how much money they get from us, it's still not enough. It's always not enough. I'm signing a pledge that if I win this election, I will do everything I can to get rid of red light cameras. This was my position 4 years ago, and now with a lot of candidates signing this pledge, I think that this is really something that can finally be resolved, and we can get rid of Chicago and our world of those red light cameras. They are unfair, they are taking our money away, and they have to be gone. And I will work for it very hard to get rid of the red light camera on Archer Avenue and Narragansett, that I got a couple of tickets there. So I will work very hard to remove them. Thank you.
Our next question is, when will Austin Avenue reopen? I think we can generalize that and say, what about our long-term public works projects here in the 23rd Ward? What's your opinion? And if you know, answer that question directly. When will Austin Avenue reopen? Candidate Carell?
I think this is a question for Alderman Zalewski. Because as far as I know, I think Archer Avenue, Austin Avenue is already open, isn't it? I know that it's been going on, you know, for months. And I've heard a lot of people complaining about it because it really increases the travel time, the inconvenience, the dust, you name it. And any time the long-term projects like this, you know, we have to realize that they take time. But people need to know, people need to be informed why and what's the purpose of doing this project and how long this is gonna take to do it. And if they say that it's gonna be, they're gonna be done in 3 or 4 months, let's stick to that date. Give people realistic information and stick to the information that you give them, because there's a lot of promises that are not delivered. And this is only frustrates the residents. There's no need for this. We understand that we need a lot of infrastructure improvements and we need new sewers because of the, a lot of flooding within a year or two. But people need to know, because once residents are informed what's going on, it will be much easier for them to deal with it. We wouldn't have questions like that, how long this is gonna take to do it. It's been already over, I think, at least half a year. So hopefully, you know what, this is not really a question to me. I can only tell you what I could do if I became an alderman. But this is really a question of, you know, for our incumbent, who would answer it.
I agree with Anna. It is a question for Michael Zalewski to be here and answer this question. This is something that maybe he's privy to. I'm not privy to that information as of yet. We also have 55th and Keeler closed, and all these are main thoroughfares, so they do cause an inconvenience to people. People have to reroute, and all of a sudden, you know, the smaller streets have a lot of cars passing by, and it creates a safety hazard as well as a inconvenience. But one thing I do want to mention is the flooding that people experience here in Garfield Ridge. I know that this summer there was several times that it rained, and people were flooded. And I remember one instance where we got a call. We actually put the word out for people who were flooded, if there were senior citizens that were in need of help. And we did get somebody on Facebook who messaged us, and they said, hey, my dad's a senior citizen, he needs help. Alderman Zalewski was out there taking names as if something was gonna happen. We were out there taking action. We went out and helped Mr. Hartuk, who lives one block away from Alderman Zalewski. And we went out and we helped him clean his basement out. And that's the type of ward that I'm gonna run, is a ward of action, one that's gonna help the people. I would also like to create a program, sort of like the 50-50 program for the sidewalks, where if the homeowner pays 50%, the city can pay 50% for flood control systems for their homes.
This will be our final question for the aldermanic candidates. We'll ask them to conclude after we conclude this last question with a 2-minute summary. And our final question reads, should the city of Chicago transfer Park District land for a potential President Obama presidential library? Why or why not? Candidate Arteaga.
All right, so I heard the president's speech last night, so I'm very favorable to him right now. And the question here has to do with our Park District land. And I feel that our Park District land should always be preserved, not only in regards to the Obama Library, but in regards to the Star Wars Museum, which I'm totally against. I'm a big Bears fan. If you look at my campaign signs, they're Bears colors, and that's by purpose. And I think that our parkland should be preserved as well as our Bears parking spots, because tailgating is a big tradition here in Chicago. If we lose that, it's gonna be terrible. But to answer the question is, we'd have to really dig deeper as to what the sentiment around the city of Chicago is in terms of that park space. Granted, it's on the south side and it's near University of Chicago, and we wanna make sure that we honor our president, but we have to be very careful about taking up public park space.
Well, I'm totally against this. I agree that we should build a president's library, but not at our expense. Seems like our parks are shrinking and shrinking and shrinking. The big business, the big corporations are taking advantage of our land that is devoted for our kids to play at, okay? And we witness time after time after time that our prime land for our devoted and for our children are being taken away from it. The place that they wanna build Obama Library is a huge park on East Side. And it's very few locations, very few lands that it's devoted entirely to our family spent together, afternoons, Sundays, holidays. We cannot sacrifice our parks and our priceless land to build something that it can be built anywhere else. Look around, there is plenty of vacant property, prime land that the library can be built on, but not in a park. And if I'm elected alderman, then I will definitely be against it. We cannot take advantage of our parks. Our parks are paid with our taxpayers' money, and we should have something to say about it. Why don't we have a referendum, ask the residents what you want to do with your land, with your property. This is your property, you pay for it. Let's fight for it. I cannot tell you how many issues there are right now pending in City Hall that nobody asks the residents how they feel about it. Our aldermen go and voice their opinion, the yes vote, yes or no, without ever getting any input from constituents. Their yes or no should reflect our opinion. Thank you.
Thank you, candidates. Well done. We'll ask each candidate to give a 2-minute concluding speech. And we'll start with candidate Arteaga.
Well, first of all, I'd just like to thank my almighty God for allowing me to stand before you. I'd also like to thank Michelle for allowing me to be here. And thank you guys for all wanting to be here, be informed about this upcoming election. This aldermanic race affects you more than the presidential race affects you. This is as local as it gets, and thank you for being engaged. Please go back and talk to your neighbors. Let them know the real issues that were discussed here, and not the fluff or the negative campaigning that's gonna be going on, any of the mudslinging and whatnot. I anything that I say today and anything that I've spoken about, Alderman Zaleski, are facts. These are not personal attacks that I've made. These are just factual things that you guys need to know about. So thank you very much for the opportunity to present here, and I look forward to working hard for you. I'm gonna work as hard for your families as I do for mine. Thank you very much.
Yeah, I would like to thank you for giving me this opportunity to introduce myself, to briefly state what my platform is, what I'm gonna be fighting for if elected. A lot of people here that I know, you know that my door is always open. I'm a good listener, and I'm the problem solvers. I'm go-getter. If you need a really true representation in City Hall, then I'm your guy. I'm your woman. I always deliver. My point is clear, it's transparent. I am a fighter. And I just want to know before I end that, you know, election always brings a lot of rumors, lies. Anything can be done to win the election. And I would like to address one issue. There are rumors about me that I don't live in a 23rd ward. There are rumors about me that I deal with Section 8. If I win, then I'll bring all the Section 8 and the blacks and Mexicans to the community. There is a rumor about me that I cheat my property taxes. Well, please, I encourage you to look up the public record. Everything is a public record. Everything about me that they say is untrue. And if Alderman Zaleski was here, I would tell him in his eye, you are the liar. The prison captains, you campaign workers, knocking at people's doors and telling people that I don't live in the 23rd ward, knowing that I've been here besides the vacation, couple of weeks of vacation that I took in 32 years, there is not even one day that I not spend in my own bed on Archer Avenue and Natchez. So don't tell me and don't tell voters, because I believe that you are smart enough to look up the records and see for whatever, for, you know, I'm here to tell the truth, and I'm not afraid to tell the truth. So if Alderman Zalewski were here, I would tell him, Alderman Zalewski, you and your precinct captains and your precinct workers are liars. I live in the 23rd ward, I don't work for Section 8, and I do not cheat on property taxes. Thank you.
All right, once again, on behalf of the 23rd Ward, Garfield Ridge Civic League, thank you for coming this evening. One Aldermanic candidate is here in person, and one has a representative here. So we'll use the same format as we used in the Aldermanic section. Mayoral, I'm sorry, thank you. So here, going first, speaking on behalf of Chuy Garcia, mayoral candidate, is Alderman Rick Muñoz.
Thank you, Ed, and thank you to the Garfield Ridge Civic Association for hosting this forum. It's a great turnout by some good neighbors who are interested in improving their community. I'm here on behalf of candidate for mayor, Jesus Chuy Garcia. Jesus was first elected alderman of the 22nd Ward back in 1986, and what can I tell you about him? He's a Southwest Sider. He's a Southwest Sider, true and true, who has devoted his entire life to making it, bringing improvements to the Southwest Side. He is currently right now the Cook County Commissioner of the 7th District, which represents the Southwest Side also, and he's running for mayor because he believes we can do better. He believes that we need to stand up to this administration and do a couple things. Number one, put an end to these red light speed light cameras because they're picking our pockets. Number two, stop giving away our parkland. Stop giving away our parkland to these private endeavors. It was talked about during the Aldermanic debate here, where we don't need a Star Wars museum on our lakefront. And he is against that and doesn't want that. He wants to stand up to this mayor and change that policy. And number two, as much as we like President Barack Obama and want the Obama Foundation to select Chicago as the site, it should not be in a park. Bottom line. It could be somewhere else. It should be, ideally, it should be by U of I. But as mayor, Mayor Garcia will make sure that it does not go in a park space. And then thirdly, he wants to bring development back to the neighborhoods. There has been a downtown Ivory City-centric development policy in this city for 4 years. Too much of our TIF dollars have been going to downtown developments, and those TIF dollars should be going into the neighborhoods. And that's why Chuy Garcia is running for mayor, and that's why he apologizes that he couldn't be here, but it's a big city. I know Alderman, my good friend Alderman Bob Fioretti, already knows that. It's a big city, and we're getting invitations from all over the city to visit, to be with you, to hear from you guys. But the most important part here is that we stand up to this mayor because he's been picking our pockets. We stand up to his mayor to make sure that we do something about the 50 school closings. You stand up to this mayor to make sure that we do something about the mental health clinics that he closed because it's not fair. And that's why I'm here to ask for your support, to beg for your support for Jesus Chuy Garcia for mayor. Thank you.
Also running for mayor is candidate Bob Fioretti, alderman from the 2nd Ward in Chicago. Let's welcome Bob Fioretti.
Thank you. Thanks so much. Thank you. Thank you, everyone, and thank you for coming out tonight. This is an important election. You know, Chicago is moving in the wrong direction, and I'm Bob Fioretti, and I'm running because I love Chicago. My values were shaped on the South Side by my Italian immigrant father, working class, Polish-American mother. I became a civil rights lawyer and now lead the fight to move a progressive vision in the city council. During my time as a civil rights lawyer, I fought the wrongs in our justice system. As alderman, I push an agenda that stands for all families, not just those at the top. I fought corporate giveaways. I've marched for a living wage for our workers. And I have and continue to, even today, introduce common sense proposals to get this city working again. Now, you know, we have a choice on election day. More of the same of career politicians or a new direction of this city. And I'm the one to lead this city in a new direction. I fought in the trenches. You know, it's not a question of standing up to Mayor Rahm Emanuel, because he won't be there when I'm the mayor. It's how we create the new direction. So if somebody wants to stand up and vote against his budget, stand up and run for alderman. You know, as I said, I'm the candidate with the experience to get us there. We need a leader who's both tough and fair. I want a Chicagoan that works for everyone, not just the big donors or the special interest unions that give the money, but for everyone in this city, no matter who you are and where you come from. Ask anyone at City Hall, especially the mayor, and I wish he was here. I know where he is right now, and I know where the other candidate is right now. They're both being interviewed by the Illinois Education Association. But, you know, on council days, everybody knows I'm not a rubber stamp. And I say, why? Because I stand up for what I say and for the people and what I believe in. You know? And I stand up for the people that this administration leaves behind. And Chicago has a lot of needs. Economic development and jobs outside of the loop, more officers on the street, solving our fiscal problems today and not tomorrow, especially our pension problem. Thank you. Support our neighborhood schools and clinics and small businesses, and especially the noise problem around here. I introduced a resolution last month that went to the aviation, especially here and up at O'Hare. And those are the issues that address us. And I want to thank everybody for being here today. And I hope you're able to share my vision with me. And I want to earn your vote this February. Thank you, everybody.
Since candidate Fioretti is the only candidate here, he will field the questions that have been asked. I believe we have four lined up for him. You have 2 minutes to answer each question. The first one is,
No,
they're not actually. Are current efforts to reduce crime working, and what could be changed about that?
Well, the answer, first of all, I did lay out a very extensive proposal last Friday under Bob, and you can go to on my website, bobfioretti.com. It's our public safety platform. First of all, no matter what the superintendent says, we do need more police officers on the street. We need about, and I know under the budget, we can hire 500 more today, not tomorrow. Can we get to that 1,000? This budget's gonna be a mess come even by June. And so we're gonna have to look at it, because we're faced with a pension obligation that we need to pay next year in 2016 of between $500 and $800 million. And I don't want, and in my view, no property tax raises to pay for that. We'll find other ways to pay for that pension obligation. And it is our obligation. We have to reopen the mental health clinics, $2 million. At the same time, we need a robust, holistic approach in solving crime. And we do that by a good neighborhood policing system. You know, there's a lot of ways, and more importantly, bringing jobs. Bringing jobs in our communities will reduce crime across the board.
I guess you can just stay right by my side here. If elected mayor, would you keep Police Superintendent Jerry McCarthy?
Well, I think the Sun-Times let it out today. The answer was, and first of all, I didn't really want to give that answer, that I'm going to replace him. I have to work with him. I think it's important. I work with all my commanders. I do drive-arounds. I've been very fortunate. The ward I represent is a microcosm of the city. And I had six police districts in that. And in the new ward, under the ROM remap, I have three police districts. And I work with my commanders all the time and what we're going to do. And as you read the Sun-Times, yes, he will be replaced, and there are very competent people within the rank and file under that serve our communities right now.
Candidate, do you support the use of red light cameras? Why or why not?
Well, first of all, I know there's never been a doubt, because you can ask the other candidates, and sometimes I'm not sure where they stand on it. But they will be gone, okay? They will. Red light cameras have to go. And I say this, how do we then fill the $70 million hole in the budget? Because that's how much we're generating, right? Well, if we were so concerned about revenue, because then they shouldn't be there. It's only there for safety. Now, Scott Waugh is back. Rick even joined on the letter. Scott and I wrote the letter that went to the Inspector General, not once, but we wrote two letters to the Inspector General that resulted in the two reports by the Inspector General. But under the last letter that we signed last February that we sent to him, and it generated the report in October, there was a question that said, can you tell us any intersection where a red light camera was that you made improvements and you took the red light cameras out because of safety improvements? Because there are simple solutions to having good intersections. The answer was no. You know, we know that the red light cameras have increased rear end accidents. These things have to go, period.
And should the Chicago Public Schools Board be appointed or elected?
Who's sending these? Is it somebody from my staff? The answer, clearly, I've been in favor of an elected school board since I first ran and I came in 2007. We need an elected school board that represents our communities, represents the diversity. We wouldn't have insider dealing, which this mayor thinks is okay. I called for the resignation of the woman who's now profiting off of her position the day it came out. You know, I mean, now she's going to give the money to charities. I don't know. It's bad money then. It's bad money to the charities. It doesn't make sense. We need an elected school board. The sooner we have it, the better it is for everyone. We're the only school district in the state that doesn't have one. And we need one now. Thank you.
He's nothing if not succinct, isn't he? Very to the point. That's the written questions that we have. I think that'll be okay, because I'm sure they can stick around a little bit and answer your one-on-one questions very happily. But again, we'll give you the same opportunity that the aldermanic candidates have. You want to give a two-minute conclusion?
Well, I do want to thank everybody for coming out tonight. You know, we always hear that expression, oh, this is the most important election in our lifetime. Well, I think this time it is. I think the heart and soul of this city is at issue. You know, every community, I used to think Chicago was a melting pot. It's actually a mosaic of great communities, of great people. But I'm really tired of hearing from all constituents around this city that they've got one foot out the door. They want to move. I was just at the endorsement session, and people said to me, they're leaving. They can't afford this city. You know, we can't raise property taxes. I think the question to every candidate who's running, are you going to raise property taxes or not? Because I guarantee, today if we had on the board to fund what we need to do, are you going to raise property taxes, they probably would have had the five people that were not being challenged say yes, and the rest would have been no. But the day after the election, it's going to be a complete flip-flop. Candidates aren't talking about the hard issues that what we need. And you know what? As I said, do we want more of the same? Or do we want a new direction for this city? And deal with the problems that affect this city. Crime, economic development, our fiscal health, our education. I'm willing to take on these issues. I want you to help me. I want to earn your support. Go to bobfioretti.com, see what else we stand for. And I thank everybody again for coming out tonight.
And that about does it. If I think I feel the way you feel. I think this was a good evening. We should do more of these, or we really should, to get the candidates out going forward in future elections. I'll be more than happy to moderate them, so if you want me to do that, just let me know through your organization, and we can do that. Again, please be careful going home. God bless you, and we'll see you at the next Garfield Ridge Civic League meeting, too. Thank you very much. Good night, everybody.